I'll get out of your way. You never get in the way of panelists walking to their seats or in the way of food or drinks. So you two, come on up. So we'll go around. First, Alistair. Alistair Anderson. Hello, Alistair. Ming.
Nice to meet you.
Hello. Mike.
Nice
okay. So what I'll do first is, why don't we go along and spend a couple minutes each. Just give first some thoughts on your journey in Hadoop inside of your organization, just to set some context for everyone, and then clearly we'll go through some other questions. So Alistair, since you're next to me, why don't you first introduce yourself to the group and then give a little context on where you are in the journey.
Okay, thanks Herb. My name's Alistair Anderson, I work for HSBC. Within the investment banking division, I'm responsible for the architecture and design function. I think I'm here representing the sort of conservative side of the enterprise. We are very early on our adoption of Hadoop, and we're looking at the benefits it can bring to our organization. We've done quite a lot of work over the last year in testing out the technology and building up a business value case and seeing how it can be used and bring a real differentiator to our business in terms of cost management, but also product build. So I think I'm representing the cautious eye, if you like, for organizations.
Okay, thanks Alistair. Ming, for eBay, how about yourself?
So first of all, thanks for the opportunities. It's a great honor to be here. My name is Ming Ma, I'm a dev manager at Hadoop platform team at eBay. eBay has one of the biggest Hadoop clusters in the world, so we have seen lots of opportunities and challenges in the way we operate and develop Hadoop. I joined eBay about 2 years ago, after I spent almost 11 years at Microsoft working on Bing and Windows software. So I think Hadoop is a great open source project, and I personally learned a lot, and I hope to continue to learn from the journey.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ming. Mike from Neustar.
Mike Peterson, I'm the VP of Architecture, Data, and Platform Services at Neustar, and we started our Hadoop adventure about 2.5 years ago with the notion that our new CEO recognized that we produce a lot of data, and we were keeping about 1% of that data for a little over 60 days. And she said to me, I want all of it for a year. And so we embarked on this and put together an initial business case to where we had our data warehouse was sitting on Netezza platforms and Oracle platforms. And just by eliminating some licenses from Oracle and the maintenance of Netezza, we funded our initial Hadoop cluster and have been going strong. We are well over, we've hit our goal of 100%, and we're well over a year's worth of data at this point.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So Mike, why don't we continue on with you since we're here. So as you started on that first project and started to move from 1% of the data and start to manage more, what were some of the insights you found early on as you just started to collect the information and collect the data?
Yeah, so it goes a range of things. Clearly we've been hearing about how people initially use this as a data store. That's a good way to start. And that was our initial opportunity that we did. And we quickly got into also transitioning our data warehouse. We went, a three-layer architecture like everybody else. But in the same time frame, we decided to do open source for everything. So we moved from Netezza to Postgres and Grid SQL, and then put some edge databases on the top tier. And so we learned a lot about moving data around and the different tools with that. And as data became available to a lot of our data users and a lot of our customers, they began to come up with ideas of what to do. I think when we went into this, we didn't really understand, other than the low-hanging fruit, what were some of the real analytics that we wanted to do. We're well over 2 petabytes worth of data heading to 3, and lots of different varieties. If you know anything about Neustar, you start to know the variety of data that we have. And I think the biggest thing for me is, we started out as a telecom services company, and this has revolutionized our culture in engineering by moving to open source, becoming part of the community.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Mike. Ming,
yes.
For eBay, if you think back to the the earlier days as eBay was using Hadoop and starting to leverage it as a capability, right, inside of mining information. Maybe just give some thoughts on what were some of the initial insights that eBay started to gain, and then how did they start to expand on that more?
Yeah, eBay started the first Hadoop cluster in 2007. The main driver behind that is because eBay has huge amount of data about the users and inventories. It has more than 100 million sellers and buyers, a couple hundred million listed items. So this generates lots of transactional data as well as unstructured data, such as image, web access log, item description, things like that. So there's a strong demand that for the system to enable developers and scientists to do machine learning and data mining on large scale. So that's where the thing started, around 2007. I believe that's the around the time the first version of Hadoop came out. Mm-hmm. And a couple folks built up 10 node clusters. And that's how things started. And since then, we have seen exponential growth every year. And today, we have a shared cluster that has tens of petabytes of storage and tens of thousands of cores for computation. So one of the things we learned during this journey is that automation is very important in Hadoop. And I think that's what the Ambari and other system are trying to do is when you operate and manage a huge cluster like this, automation is the key because we cannot keep adding more people to manage a bigger cluster. The other thing we sort of learned a lot about this is that putting everything in a shared cluster, it's a good thing because it actually reduces our operational costs. So that's two things I sort of learned.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Ming. So Alistair, I know you were earlier on in that journey, right, compared to starting in 2007, 2008, and other times. But as you think about kind of your first couple of steps in the journey, which is probably more like most people in this room today, how do you see those first couple of steps playing out in terms of how you're starting to look at the Hadoop inside of HSBC?
So, I mean, the trigger points for our organization were just a difficulty in bringing analytical projects to market. Our time to market within the sort of design part and delivery part of analytic projects was becoming a real challenge to us. We had this experience where by the time we'd actually delivered the platforms, the questions the business were asking were changing. So we have this sort of soundbite that we say, you know, we're answering yesterday's questions tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And really, rather than a hard processing limit or a data storage limit, we were hitting a design time limit that we just weren't quick enough within IT to deliver the business needs and requirements. So that was our trigger point to say, is there another way? So what we were looking at is a platform that could enable us to do a more agile style of data delivery, where we could run parallel streams. What we had seen within the legacy projects or the sort of traditional technologies that would use RDBMS or ETL is that because of the delays in time to market, we ended up, instead of a consolidation of information, a divergence and a disparate set of data sets. So the bank doesn't have a single data warehouse within the division. It has multiple warehouses. And the business requirements haven't changed. Globally, we want to ask single questions of all our operations globally. Therefore, to be able to do that, we have to have a platform that allows us to do non-disruptive parallel development. It has to be more consolidated. It has to bring data and processing together. So speak to those challenges of fragmentation with an approach that allows us to simplify our infrastructure much more. And that's how we landed in Hadoop. And what we've done to date is test out those sort of feelings that we had about the advantages that the technology could give. So we took our division's analytical platforms, which is about, it's three data warehouses and 15 data marts on traditional RDBMS technology with a sort of server farm of ETL services. Could we integrate that into a single Hadoop platform? So we took that into, I'm closely involved in the work we do within our innovation labs, and we took that sort of legacy architecture and placed it into a single Hadoop cluster on the innovation labs. Now, I'm not going to say it's super fantastic and, you know, everything happened overnight. We had a bit of a cheat sheet in that we knew the schemas, we knew what everything looked like. But in terms of a migration, a consolidation, you know, where we were spending months, we were able to do those jobs in weeks. Where we were spending weeks, we were able to execute in days. So it really spoke to that design time challenge that we had. And we were able to deliver a fully consolidated platform 6 weeks, which is fantastic for us. When you then kick in, we've then went on to look at, in terms of a business proposition and a business value case, the economics that the platform brings. You then get the benefits of the runtime. So within traditional environments, our spend on RDBMS and ETL is pretty significant. Just in terms of the CPUs we're using, and what we're seeing is that Hadoop allows you to take you know, your same investment, but it's really a margin play. It allows you to reduce your costs while being able to grow more products and more services. So we were able to take, I think it was about 60 CPUs worth of traditional technology and do a higher level of execution on, I think it was 40% of those CPUs. Mm-hmm. So what we see is that the value play for the business is in being able to redirect current spending. I mean, the CIOs in our company, and I'm sure in a lot of other companies here, are under significant cost constraints. And the business are asking us to redivert runtime costs into change costs. They want to be able to invest, or they want to maintain their investment. They don't want to have to do significant spend in order to grow their products. And that's where we're positioned with it just now. We've proved out the functionality within the innovation space and the testing space. We've got some pilot projects that have went forward. But really, we only use it when we absolutely have to. So that's to say, we use it for unstructured data that doesn't naturally fit into our legacy platforms. But we're now looking at how we can reduce some of the bottlenecks in legacy. So not replace it completely, but certainly evolve those platforms and reduce some of the fragmentation. So it's really a simplification effort that we're looking at, and that's where we see the real beauty of this technology.
Okay. So it sounds like, I would expect this is something that everyone in the audience would want to know, is how do I help build the business case and find the funding, right, around how to go get started on this journey. It sounds like for yourself at HSBC, much of that was around current cost structures and existing technologies for storing that information, and then how can you do that more cost effectively and probably expand the amount of information you're able to go capture. And Mike, for Neustar, would you say similar, different in terms of how you started that journey, were able to go secure funding?
Yeah, without question, you know, we use, if we have a chart, you've seen the chart, where we, you know, looked at some of the other vendors out there, and obviously Oracle and Netezza were part of that. And where we were have been paying $100,000, and again, this is 3 years ago, we would have been paying $100,000 a terabyte, or for us to go to the next level in the Netezza, you know, was in the millions of dollars. Versus going into a Hadoop infrastructure, our goal was to get under, you know, $500 a terabyte, which we're right about 500 in the Hadoop cluster, and as you know, we've done a little experimentation with QFS and and even getting a little bit better than $500 a terabyte with that technology. So that has driven the initial business case. And we're a company that's highly focused on OpEx. And you know, and so when we can eliminate OpEx and use capital and then have that ongoing OpEx line lower, which we all want, right, for maintenance and stuff, that's a great business case to present the finance department.
And so the initial use case, was it more around how you can store existing information more cost effectively, or how you can capture new types of information at a better cost structure?
Well, the goal was, how do you capture 100% of our data?
Okay.
our CEO asks us lots of questions like that. But I always have to get through the finance gauntlet. And the way I could do that was to say, here's my problem. My mm-hmm. solution, my business case, is really around eliminating OPEX. Mm-hmm. And so that was what I had to use. I mean, you have all those other objectives and goals and, you know, and things that we aspire for, but I still have to get through the finance gauntlet, and that's mm-hmm. how I did it.
Okay. And Ming, how about for eBay in terms of securing yeah. funding as you look, because you're further along in the journey, but as you look, as you continue to go, move along, what are some of the metrics you based it on to say, here's why we're going to be able to spend more on this type of technology and utilize it more across the enterprise?
You know, based on my knowledge, I think based on the growth eBay has, and I think the company just realized that the data is one of the biggest assets for the company. And there are lots of desire to allow developer and scientists to explore the data in its own raw format. You know, you don't want to schematize the data upfront. You don't need to know the question upfront before you want to do the research and development. So I think that's sort of one of the biggest driving factor that eBay has. There's just a very strong demand within the company and the leaders in the company knows about it, that this is the way to go in terms of doing, allowing many people in the company to do big data analytics. I think there are some numbers out there in terms of the return on investments. I think every year people review that and the company say, wow, it's a great return on the investment. So that's why the cluster size keep growing exponentially in the last couple of years until we reach a critical size now. That is one of the biggest. So that's probably a magnification that, you know, this is really a big deal for the company.
Yeah. I can imagine the scale, because we did that recently where we said, in the 2 years that we've been doing it, we can identify $4 million in cost savings by using this storage mechanism and this approach versus what we would have had to gone through the last 2 years. So at eBay, that scale must be something astronomical.
Yep. That's right. Mm-hmm.
But I think it sounds like similar across all three organizations in terms of what the cost drivers are as well as where you see the benefits and the savings in terms of how to get started.
Yeah, I think one of the things that you know, we've done, and I haven't heard the guys speak to, is we've tried to do within the context of our division a projection of what those savings would be in terms of infrastructure, but also in terms of the design time. So we did modeling on this, and I've done projections on this, and what this allows us to do is take those projections and project them over the whole estate. Now, we're a multi-billion dollar estate, and therefore those numbers become very, very compelling. But what you have to do is it's a stepwise process. So it's easy doing these sort of voodoo economics, to use an Americanism, but you've got to prove that value along the way. And the low-hanging fruit for institutions like ourselves would be the amount of processing we do within legacy you know, mainframes and mid-range platforms. Just very simple file-based processing, you know, not a complex analytics, not product out of data, but just offloading some of those very expensive, very reliable, and we like them environments, we're not getting rid of them, but we need to release some of the pressure off that, and that will release some of the operational expenditure and capital expenditure that can justify you know, the steps along your sort of big data journey.
Okay. And question B is, do you see Hadoop typically starting in an organization as a way from a technology project to go create a technology project that they can go solve some business problems, or is there a specific business driver saying, we need to go solve this, now let's go find the right technology and the right way to go solve that problem? Well, we'll start with you, Alistair.
I would say both. So we are definitely seeing parallel streams of demand within the enterprise. So there are some projects that demand, you know, almost eBay levels of data. We have, you know, multi-terabytes coming on to petabytes worth of information, and we have never been able to process singularly before in terms of data and analytics. So those projects are definitely coming on stream. They're driven by various factors. It could be just the demand for the enhanced regulation that's being asked globally, and the ability for us to be able to run models and what-if scenarios on our portfolios that the governments and regulators are asking for. It could be that we want to offer a global perspective on our clients' information, and that's something that's been a significant challenge for us, and that drives us to these kind of platforms, because really the traditional platforms, when they can scale, the capital expenditure barrier to entry is just horrendous. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to buy, I talk about the refrigerator in the data center, you know, you have to go out and buy that great big box. Whereas with a Hadoop solution, you can buy, the barrier to entry is much lower, and you know that you can incrementally build as your business builds and as you bring data online. So that integration of information comes at a price point that makes sense. So you have a linear cost model rather than having to buy a great big chunk of hardware and then having to justify that or amortize that over a number of years to get that return on investment. So we're seeing that, but we're also seeing that there is a general demand in the business for something new and innovative, and that ability to monetize the data flows that we have in-house that we capture both internally and externally. So that business innovation is definitely driving other parts of the agenda. I see that more. So I work within the back office. I'm responsible for the back office. So I'm really focused on cost because we're an economy of scale operator. Whereas in the front office, where product development is more a primary concern, you can see that the business are actually taking the lead. So the guys looking after sales operations on the trading floor are really pushing innovative ways of monetizing those data flows that they have in-house. You know, we've got terabytes of data thrown through the organization every day, and there is an inherent value in that, and they're looking to capitalize on that. So definitely I see parallel streams of demand for this product.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And Mike, as you've gone further along this journey, as you started along this with one initial project, right, to store more information beyond the 1% currently stored. As you got started, was it more on the technology or the business side that you started to find new applications and other ways to start leveraging the technology to get value?
It almost segment ours into three goals, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to be pragmatic. We all have to be pragmatic. We'd love to have an unlimited budget to go experiment and get into analytics, but we sort of have this idea that we're still business, we still have to operate like a profitable business. So we started out with a very pragmatic, simple business case, but on the edge, we're sort of midterm and long-term goals. One of the things that Neustar has been trying to do is pivot itself more into being an analytics and information company. So what that requires is culture change and a mindset change. And also, we did some acquisitions. We acquired a company that had an analytics platform, certainly not based on Hadoop or anything like that. So the notion is, how do we feed that into that platform? So the big goal is culture change and shifting the business. The midterm is, how do we get people to think about data as a business? How do we build a data science practice? And one of the things that we did there was we opened up a lab at the University of Illinois because of their reputation. And then we had the very tactical, pragmatic storage problem, make data accessible, keep the data, and have that as a 1.5 year operational plan, and learn how to operate as we go along there. So we segmented that. So it isn't like we hit this goal and we were done. Mm-hmm. We actually are building, and I thought some of the presentations at the keynote yesterday, both Matt and Sean talked about the fact that, there's this scaling in over the chasm, and we certainly follow that pattern right to the T. And I think you and I talked earlier about this, that the other overhanging thing is, how do we build a data governance platform right on top of this? because we can't just willy-nilly share data anywhere. We have to think about, you know, the PII, the contractual, and then also Neustar. I mean, the heart of Neustar's name is neutrality, because we started out to a number party. So we have a brand issue too, so governance overhangs that. So as you look at segmentation of goals and walking through that, you know, you have all these things that play in at different points.
You know, it's interesting you say that, because you talk through the examples not only of how data can help your business, but become a data-driven business. And data is actually helping fundamentally change your business in terms of where you want to go.
Yeah.
And that's an, you know, an interesting concept along the journey, is how companies fundamentally change and data becomes one of the ways they can go leverage that along the journey.
Yeah, the side benefit has been open source. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, Hadoop and you guys in particular have been great partners in leading us into becoming part of the community. Well, from that, you know, we went into Postgres, and we're doing OpenStack. We're doing a lot of open source stuff, which is also part of that cultural change that we need to get people, you know, our engineers to be part of the community and to think about being more involved and being excited about, you know, going in and being responsible and taking accountability for the changes they make in the code.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. Ming, with eBay, when you think about the community, how does eBay, you know, I'll say, work with the community, leverage mm-hmm. the community, give back, and sort of work within the, I'll say, that group, that organization?
Sure. The way eBay works with the community has evolved over time. And in early days, we just take whatever community provides and deploy and run it in our clusters. As we gain more experience in operating the clusters and getting better knowledge about Hadoop, we start to be more active with community. Normally, the way we approach this problem is we always start from the problem we encounter in our production cluster or development cluster. We spend time doing root cause analysis, finding the problems, and we test it in our cluster, and we push the fix back to open source. A good example is the last year we enabled security within eBay. Due to the specifics constraint in eBay security infrastructure, Hadoop security cannot run inside eBay. So one of our engineers actually spent time changing Hadoop code and to make it work for eBay scenarios. And then he worked with Hortonworks, we worked with open source to push the fix back to the community. And from time to time, we also want to take a look what are the new incubation projects out there. And we also want to be in the early part of the evaluation phase with the community. So we'll probably spend more and more time on those type of projects as well.
Okay. So from your view, staying close to the community or working and interacting with the community, something important to eBay, something that you see?
Yeah, I think this is very important for eBay. Well, first of all, we can get the best out of the community. So at the same time, I would say running Hadoop in one of the biggest clusters in the world is a great test for the Hadoop system itself. So along the way, we find problems, we fix problems, and we contribute the things back to Hadoop. So I think it's a win-win situation for both eBay and the community.
Mm-hmm. And Alistair, as you think about the community, and again, I know you're earlier on, but how do you see yourself interacting, or HSBC, you know, working? You're in a different world, you're in the financial services world, it's a little different, but how do you see yourself working with the community?
Well, I think open source in general we see as a positive. I think more so than that, if we weren't able to engage with the open source community, we would really be left behind. It'd be a competitive disadvantage. Mm-hmm. I mean, that said, we are not going to commit code to any of the projects or have committers on staff. It's not the sort of relationship we are looking for. However, we are keen to engage and inform the community of you know, the sort of requirements an organization like ours would have. We would probably be looking to do that through partners. What we're really looking for off the community is learning, I would say, and shared experience. My colleague who runs the e-commerce team has a great phrase when he's looking for developers. He says the biggest skill that he's looking for is scars. So who's been battle scarred? Who knows how things work? Who knows how things break? And who knows how to fix things? And that's really the benefits we see in a community is this, that in the spirit of sharing, you can eliminate the amount of surprises within your project. So, you know, we encourage, the bank encourages our people to engage in the communities, but it's, you know, it's got to be on sort of our terms as well. So we wouldn't be committing to the community, but we were happy to share our experiences and also learn from others as well. So we have a number of forums where internally we have developer forums, and we try to channel that back into the open source world so we can you know, help inform the projects of the needs of an enterprise like ourselves.
Okay. And Mike, as you think about how you've gone along the journey, you started with Hadoop in one segment, one section. Do you see this moving towards more of a shared platform, a shared service across the organization? Are you already there?
Yeah, we're already at a shared service. And, you know, we had, one of the other big initiatives at Neustar is to take our three divisions and, you know, start doing a lot of more as one vision, one company. And the Hadoop infrastructure has helped a lot because people are starting to look at, you know, what data is available to them. Does this person get this third-party data? Can I use that data? And they're starting to share that knowledge. And one of the things we're going to do this year internal in the company is we're going to have our first data summit. So we started having a technology summit where we share technology across the company. But now data is becoming such an important thing. In May, we're having a data summit where we're bringing all the different factions around the company, and to deal with not this just as a shared service, but as a shared vision.
Okay. And eBay, you're obviously a very large company with divisions in marketplace and financial services with PayPal and Clear Sailing and StubHub and everything all along. Do you see that turning into a shared service or staying as independent across each of the different businesses?
Yeah, so we are definitely seeing the trend to converge into a bigger shared cluster. To some degree, we're already running Hadoop as a shared service at eBay. There are many interesting applications, ad hoc jobs running in our shared clusters. Some of them are production jobs, some of them are research jobs. I think my colleague Amit this afternoon will give a good overview about some interesting applications we are building on the top of Hadoop. Now, bringing back to the question about the shared cluster, even though we are running all kinds of production jobs and research jobs in our big shared cluster, for business critical applications that have very stringent SLA demands, we still run it as a dedicated cluster. An example is we in the eBay new search engine, we use Hadoop to build a search index. One of the requirements of that system is to do near real-time update. But that means you need to have a MapReduce job runs every couple minutes. The job need to finish in within a couple minutes. For those kind of scenarios, we still run it as a dedicated cluster. So my take on this is there's still lots of work that can be done to make Hadoop a truly shared multi-tenancy infrastructure service.
Yeah. Okay. Alistair, we talked a little bit about how Hadoop is one technology. We've heard a lot at this conference around how it's a component of the enterprise data architecture and fits within the overall architecture. It's not replacing everything, and it's just one piece of that. How do you see Hadoop tying into your enterprise architecture, and what are some of the other types of systems, technologies, et cetera, that needs to integrate with inside of a company like HSBC?
Well, it's absolutely got to tap into our existing data flows. So what I see as a key benefit of the technology, which is just as well because it's something it absolutely has to do, is to be able to be introduced in a non-disruptive manner. So the sort of areas where it has to tap in is to our legacy estate, to those in-flight data flows. So most of those are file-based or messaging. So we have to be able to send data to that and have a high level of ingest. We also have to be able to supply information out to, let's just call them subscribing applications. So I think the benefits of Hadoop in terms of that rationalization that we're looking to achieve wouldn't really alter the endpoints initially. So where we have a dedicated appliance or an analytical database or an e-commerce channel off an RDBMS, it's more likely that Hadoop will be a preprocessor to those environments initially. I think we have the same ambitions for the shared service as well, but I think we're a little bit more cautious in terms of the shortcomings within some of the security model, some of the DR and HA questions. So the ultimate vision would be to look at, you know, a single data platform without these intermediate endpoints and have a direct channel out to, say, the e-commerce or something like that. But we feel that initially Hadoop will be deployed as a preprocessor and have to connect to that legacy estate that I keep referring to. So it could be an RDBMS, it could be just a flat file storage area, it could be an appliance, but Hadoop has to speak to all these guys. As well as being able to ingest it, has to be able to project that information out without doing it in a way that totally disrupts. So it has to speak to protocols like GDBC and all the various industry standards, SQLs. Clearly, we're a massive SQL shop, like I think most enterprises would be. So being able to give technology and business users that level of confidence that there's not going to be a disruption to service, but you are going to get these potential benefits if we do this migration, as well as the cost squeeze, is really how we would position the technology in terms of an initial adoption and a sort of medium-term plan.
Okay. So what you just described, Alistair, is similar to what I think we heard from some of the speakers and even Sean Connolly yesterday, going through one use case or pattern of use for Hadoop as a way to, say, make it a pre-processing engine to ingest a lot of the information, a lot of the other data sources in the organization beyond just transactional data. And once you have it in there, be able to then source that into your EDW or other places.
Yes. Right?
And then talked about two other use cases. One beyond that is, can you actually run the analytics directly against Hadoop as a cluster? And can you also take some of the information that comes out of it and use it to push back into your interactive applications? There are just three patterns of use of how companies use Hadoop. How do you see yourself, Mike, across those three patterns in terms of how it fits within
the new store? I would say yes.
Okay.
No, I mean seriously, we do analytics at all layers. I mean, obviously, when we recreated the data warehouse with Postgres, we're doing aggregations and summarizations and putting it up there because, you know, there's a whole legacy of customer reporting and analytics that we're doing that. We're building new applications, you know, that are, you know, at the top tier, we're pushing things up so it'd be more real-time, near real-time, and doing that. And then long-running stuff as we build our data science capabilities, you know, we're running stuff on the Hadoop cluster and doing analytics. We recently, went with Tableau as a visualization tool, and on top of Postgres, we still use OBIE. So we have a variety of things. You know, we use SAS. So, you know, each of those things fit into the type of question and the type of problem that we're trying to ask or work towards.
And would you say, just having gone through this journey, that would the journey start typically using Hadoop as an ingest engine for many types of information, or does it go right to, I can run analytics against it and I can start to flow that information back in?
In our case, you know, there was a pent-up demand for some of this data. You know, one of the things that we all have across our infrastructure is a lot of exhaust files, log files, tag files, and stuff like that. And so as that became available, the different user groups, we segment this, and we have a platforms group, is the stuff that I have. And then we have developers. And the developers are one of our key users because, you know, we've been putting together tools and stuff to allow them to get into the Hadoop cluster and work with their end customers on things that they want to do. As soon as that data was available and they started, you know, quickly coming up to speed and, you know, how to write Hive queries and things, they were quickly in the middle of this, starting to pull that stuff to give their end user things that they had wanted. So I think as that data, you know, in our case, became available, there was a lot of pent-up demand.
Mm-hmm. Mike, can I just ask you a question? You said it was pent-up demand.
That's my job. You ask the questions? Go ahead, Alistair.
You've done a great job. Thanks for playing.
See, now you know who's going to moderate next year.
Did you have any moments where the your business community said to you, I just didn't think that was possible, you know, sort of aha moments? Because that's what we are experiencing, is that the potential or sort of that imagination within a business, they feel limited by technology. So were you meeting a need that was already there, or did you supply something that people really hadn't considered?
To be honest, I didn't target the business community. I targeted the developers.
Ah, okay.
And the reason I did that is because, at least in our company, the developers are the subject matter experts. They're writing the applications, they're writing the reporting, the analytics. So they have this, you know, this long list of things that people have been asking for, and suddenly it's there. And then they can go to their users and say, see what I did, see what's available. That's really the approach that I took.
Okay.
Okay.
Over to you.
Thank you, Alistair. Ming, how about your thoughts in terms of those three patterns of use? Right? Hadoop is a way to ingest a lot of information. Hadoop is a way to start to take that and run analytics directly against your Hadoop cluster, and then also to feed that information back in for recommendations or other areas. How do you see it?
Yeah, I think it's a very common pattern. We found that at eBay as well. Some of the unique thing I would say at eBay compared to this previous description is that the one is the scale. We have lots of data that need to be pushed from the web servers down to Hadoop. The other thing that came up is that the latency on the data ingestions. Right now, our system have stages in between, the web server log to the time it become available on Hadoop. So that's one of the problem we are trying to solve. In the middle part, analytics part, there are tons of applications running there today, and personalization, classification, recommendation, there are lots of things running. And then for a class of customers in within eBay, they are developers and scientists. They are okay to store the data in Hadoop as it is. And sometimes the data will be fed to another production system that connect to the eBay production website service. However, for another bigger audience, like a business analyst, program managers, they want to have an interactive way to do the reporting and summary data. So for that, I think we still have to move the data back to the data warehouse system, and then people can use the BI tools like Tableau to consume the data. So it's a very common pattern. At the same time, we do see a change from the different product team. They want to know if they can use Hadoop directly for business intelligence interactive query. I think that's what, you know, in this summit, a lot of people are talking about this interactive query. That will be a very big thing for eBay.
Okay. That was one area I know that Eric spoke about,
yep,
in terms of some of the projects that are coming up through the community around Yarn, around Tez, around the Stinger initiative, and some of the areas to start to help Hadoop become more of an interactive query engine.
Yep.
Now, is that something like a new start you see using Hadoop more that way? Is that a requirement to get to
I think
more
all
of
us, the faster we can get to the data, the happier we are. So mm-hmm. all those things are important. The simpler the operational platform is, Ming and I were talking a little earlier that, you know, about the size of our teams. My whole data services team is only 8 people. I did all the Postgres stuff and all the Hadoop stuff with those folks while they were maintaining all the production stuff on the Teas and Oracle. And so, you know, the other outcropping of that is they ended up doing DevOps. You know, we hadn't started down the path of saying we want to have a DevOps group, because we were bringing in one-off platforms, we were using, you know, Supermicro fat twins with, you know, multi-terabyte drives on them, that the existing SAs didn't want to work with that. So we took that on. And suddenly, you know, we're doing everything and that. So the easier it is to operate, at least from my perspective, you know, that makes it easier for my group. And, the, you know, less time they're going over to the data center having to worry about things.
Yeah. So beyond easier to operate and moving
faster
more towards
access,
an interactive query engine, any other areas in your wish list?
Well, governance.
Governance?
We talk a lot about security, but you know, again, data governance is something I haven't heard much talk about here. And that's going to be in the next problem, right? So we have all this data, but there's a lot of, whether it's PII rules or contractual rules, and as I said, brand rules for us, you know, we got to be careful how that data is segmented, is taken care of, who can access it. And I'd like to see governance start to become more part of the projects on, you know, what kind of metadata. I mean, certainly H-Catalog helps with the Hive stuff, but it doesn't really dictate governance, you know, as we store data or try to pull data out.
Okay. And Ming, similar for eBay, as you look across, you mentioned interactive already.
Yeah,
so data governance and security in those areas.
I think that's true. In addition to that, I will just add a couple more to the list. One of them is to improve the productivities around people using Hadoop. So today at eBay, the developer need to access, in order to access Hadoop, they need to first connect to a proxy server console, and then from there they can access Hadoop. So it have an impact on the productivity on Hadoop. So it would be nice if developer from their dev box, they can open up Eclipse, so any dev console, they can connect directly to production cluster. That would be a big thing. The second type of scenario is about Hadoop fundamentals, we'll call it. So one of the things I talked about earlier was multi-tenancy support. I think there's still lots of challenging work need to be done there to make HDFS, HBase a much better multi-tenant service. Another interesting scenario is disaster recovery scenarios where it would be nice if there is a cross data center strongly consistent storage layer. I don't know, it could be on HBase, it could be on HDFS, but a very strongly consistent layer that can handle data center failures. Those are very important things for certain critical data at eBay. So the last thing I will add is the make it easy to operate and manage, I think similar to what Mike was saying. I think Ambari is getting better day after day. That's awesome. Because we have a very big clusters, we want to make sure that all the tools, automations are available so that it minimizes our operational cost for that.
I mean, for that, something like Ambari for automation and for provisioning of clusters, you then take some of that and then tie that into some of your other enterprise systems that you already use for provisioning, management,
definitely,
and monitoring?
Definitely. In terms of how Ambari interacts with our security infrastructure, how to do deployment, how we manage our machine provisioning, those things all need to tie up so that it's completely automated. That would be awesome.
Okay. And then Mike, how about yourself for something like Ambari as a
management? Yeah, we've already looking into that with the help from your team. And
mm-hmm.
You know, so anyone, you know, not to give you guys a plug, but you know, it certainly is helpful for us to be closely connected to you guys. And you whether it's an upgrade or any of these new products, we're right in the middle of them, and the questions are there for, you know, answered for us. So.
Okay. Okay. Well, I know we're coming up to wrap up our session here, but one though I think would be great for everyone here is if you're to boil down all the experience you have and everything you've done with Hadoop and where you are on your journey, you could boil that down to one piece of advice you could give the audience as they're getting started on their journey. What would that one piece of advice be of what they should be thinking about or how they should get started? We'll start with you, Alistair, as we go down the line here.
I would encourage people to just try it out. You know, if you haven't started your testing or you haven't built a sort of innovation environment that allows you to, you know, define the art of the possible within the platform, I would encourage you to just give it a try. You know, the reason I'm sat here, the reason we're so sort of bullish about the technology is the level of confidence we've seen within that testing environment. And the truth really is in the platform itself. you know, one of the key thing, and I mean, the guys listed a lot of things that need improvement within the platform, but the key thing I need within the platform to enable it to be rolled out across the enterprise is trust. So for all the negatives of those legacy platforms, those we know how to work those, and they're absolutely bulletproof. So go out there and absolutely get hands-on on the technology and get that confidence that you're going to be able to need to make the justifications that are required for your business.
Okay. Ming, how about for yourself? What would be the advice you'd impart to the audience here on how they can, you know, get started, or what would be helpful to be thinking about as they start along this journey?
I think very similar to what Alex is saying is try it out first with small scale. Get a couple machines, set it up, try it out. If it works, expand the clusters. And I would say you will be amazed by this feedback you'll get from your companies. Because once you see the benefit out of Hadoop, you are going to expand. Once you expand more, you are going to have more people use it. And then you just keep growing.
Okay. And Mike, the new star.
I would say be brave. You know, I think one of the things is to trust your engineers. And one of the things that I like most about this journey we've taken is, you know, not that they were automatons or anything like that, but it's nice to see the engineers engaged in taking risk. And instead of having a problem and saying, I got to open a ticket with Oracle, they get in and they fix the problem or they figure that out. If you know, the operations group says, well, we're not going to put that drive in for you, we're going to do DevOps, that they do that and they start gaining that, you know, sort of opening up that opportunity for them and knowing they have that freedom. And be brave enough to protect them and let them take risk. That to me has been, I think, the single thing that's helped us succeed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. Well, good. Well, you know what? I want to thank all three of you. I think it's great for everyone here to be able to impart the wisdom, what you've all gone through, right, what you've seen along the Hadoop journey, to help everyone as they start along as well. So I want to thank you for all your experience and for sharing this, and for coming up here and spending the time in Amsterdam. I want to give our panelists a great hand.
Thank you. Thank you.
So I think one common theme you heard at the end as we just finished up from everybody was probably with Hadoop, the one area is just get started. And how do you at least get started, try it, experiment? Because what I've heard is once you get started, it's the art of the possible. It starts to open your eyes to what are the potentials, what are the other types of information, what's the other type of data that I can start to leverage, and how do I start to use that for advantage? And until you start to look at it, and Mike, I think you had a great comment, is you started off leveraging 1% of the data at Neustar. And from there, it was now, how do I leverage the other 99%? And once I do that, what's possible? And I'm assuming when you started out that journey, you didn't know what was possible, and you're only looking at 1% through that lens.
I'd say we still don't know, but every day something else reveals itself.
So the faster you can get started and to just try it inside of your organization, as Ming said, on a small cluster, you start to look at it, you start to see the art of the possible. You know, I will say that's one reason the Dev Cafe in the back, certainly feel free. It's a great opportunity to try it here. But also, if you don't have the time to try it here or the line's too long at the Dev Cafe, I would certainly encourage you to download Sandbox as a way just to try it inside your environment. It's free. You can try it in your environment and start to see what Hadoop can do for you, get some tutorials, start to share it. As you start to look and putting a cluster inside of your organization and say, what's the 1% of the data I want to start with, and how do I want to expand that across our usage patterns inside of the organization? And I would expect, like our esteemed panelists up here, you'll start to find other use cases will present themselves and other ways to leverage that information as you also move down to starting to become more of a data-driven business and leverage that information. You'll also go down that same journey and same path, because I heard very similar journeys, very different stages, but similar journeys in terms of whatever he's thinking about and how they can use Hadoop in their enterprise. So with that, we'll move on. I know we've got, if we go back to our agenda here for the rest of the day, or we'll just say thank you. Either way, it's the same thing. But from agenda for the rest of the day, obviously we move to a break at this point. We've got the community showcase in the back with all of our sponsors. I want to thank again all our sponsors for spending the time here and coming and helping us put on this event. So thank you, sponsors. I want to thank our co-host Yahoo as well for all of their work in helping to put on this event in Europe. And as I said, certainly we'll be back next year. We'd love to have you all join us next year and have others of you sitting on the panel here next year and sharing your experience in terms of how Hadoop started in your enterprise and where you along that journey and what else you think you can do to help the next set of people who are starting to look to use Hadoop in their enterprise and help them get started. So with that, I want to thank you all for coming to our main tent. I wish you the best as you enjoy the rest of the conference and go on to the main sessions. We've got some great tracks and some great content today as we finish off the rest of the day. So thank you again for joining us, everyone, and enjoy the rest of the conference.